And then we go to Evelina Clusa, works in Amsterdam, and she combines imaging and targeting in hyaluronan nanoparticles. And she doesn't work on tumors, she works on atherosclerosis and plaque targeting. Evelina?
Yes, please. So I hope it will be refreshing, right?
Please, yes.
So that's one of the recent studies, and I put this here because it has been just a few days ago accepted to ASCS Nanos. We are all welcome to read it. And so it's a specific study, but it shows the approach we always use to do our research. So we are in the field of atherosclerosis, and our main interest is actually inflammation associated with atherosclerosis. And just briefly, I will show it's driven by monocytes, which they're supposed to clear up the lipid deposition in the vessel wall. But this process frequently goes wrong. And so they transport monocytes into macrophages and foam cells. They actually are a source of inflammation. So these cells, the pro-inflammatory monocytes and macrophages, are our main cellular targets. And in this study, our approach to target these cells are to use hyaluronan. So I think a lot of you know that it's a biopolymer. It's one of the key components of extracellular matrix. And it has a lot of wonderful properties. And for us, what was very important that we can modify it. And it can also exert biological activity. And so we know that high molecular weight, hyaluronan, actually can block the inflammatory signaling, whereas the fragmented oligomeric can actually activate it. So this brings me to first study aim, which was about working out the formulation, which is supposed to be based on hyaluronan, the backbone supposed to be hyaluronan supposed to be its backbone for the imaging purposes. So the formulation is rather simple. So it's two main components, the hyaluronan, so the primary interest, and then small hydrophobic molecule, colanic acid. So first we have to modify hyaluronan. We introduce the primary amine groups to the carboxyl groups, quite a straightforward chemistry. And then we conjugate the activated colanic ester, NHS ester, and then this triggers the assembly of nanoparticles as shown over here. So for the labeling, we also use the same conjugation strategy, and then we use zirconium, the deferoxamine, and it was mentioned that it's about the good match between the physical half-life of this radiotracer and bio half-life of our nanoparticles. And we also label with CyDyS, and this is a super resolution image of our labeled material. So before jumping into the in vivo studies, we put quite some effort to actually characterize the formulation, and especially the effects of hydrolysis, because this was our, by hyaluronidase, the main enzyme, because this was our big fear. So what will happen after just administration to the bloodstream, that they will disappear. But all of the methods we applied, and it was atomic force microscopy, scanning electron microscopy, super resolution, they showed that they do not disappear, and they seemed quite intact, actually. And this also shows in these histograms of size distribution that actually not much happens, right? There is a big overlap. So we also use more conventional way to look at the hydrolysis. So once we looked into the release of terminal glucosamine, it's because enzyme cuts here. And then actually we didn't see a lot of differences between non-formulated hyaluronan and the nanoparticle one, yes? So enzyme still does the job, yes? But at the same time, once we use the size exclusion chromatography, then for the nanoparticles, the shift in retention time, it was hardly present. Whereas for the free hyaluronan, we definitely see the formation of a small oligomers. So we also were very much interested what happens after in vivo administration. And to this aim, we injected the material, we harvested the aortas, and then we visualized with two-color super-resolution fluorescent microscopy the endothelial layer, so the layer which covers the plaques of our interest. And this is the CD31 stained endothelial cells. And this here you can see the diffusely distributed nanoparticles. And if we compare this, actually it's ex vivo, an image of nanoparticles to the in vitro seeded on the cover glass, you see that the morphology is actually hardly changed. Another point, like our main point, so whether we can use these nanoparticles to stratify the inflammation in atherosclerosis. So we use the APOE knockout mouse model, and then use them in them either early or advanced lesions by varying the length of the high fat diet. And then we injected either fluorescent or radiolabeled nanoparticles, and the readouts were respectively or fluorescence based of autoradiography gamma counting for quantitative assessment. So this is the first piece of experiments, the flow cytometry analysis of different immune cell populations. So we could define the macrophage population, pro-inflammatory monocytes in different tissues, but I would like to focus on the comparison of macrophages in different organs with respect to the uptake of our nanomaterial. And so for the aortic macrophages, so derived from the plaques, atherosclerotic plaques, you see both for early and advanced, we see the significant difference compared to the spleen and bone marrow. But you also have to appreciate that for the early, this difference is much more pronounced. And also we see the big differences between the early and advanced atherosclerosis with respect to this aortic macrophage uptake. And we think it's something to do with a change in the phenotype of macrophages. And this profile was also confirmed by fluorescent microscopy. So you see small lesion, early lesion, and advanced ones in green macrophages, in red our nanoparticles. And once we quantified the colocalization of nanoparticles with macrophage, we see that for early atherosclerosis, the selectivity is much higher compared to the advanced atherosclerosis. And then so here 50% was actually not associated with macrophages. And this partially, or to a lot of extent, actually, this explains why what's happening. So we have here an interface between, we believe, older and fresher lesion. Here's a lot of foam cells with these black dots are the lipids. And then, so once we look at the accumulation of our contrast agent, you see that they actually don't enter the cell. Yes, they are kind of limited to the extracellular space. Where once in this fresh lesion, freshly recruited macrophages, it's more like diffuse. It really enters the cells. So we also took opportunity to look into the pathways, how the nanoparticles enter the plaque. So this is the most superficial part of the plaque, endothelial layer, and where we stained with weak adherin, it's a junctional staining. And then I hope you can also see that, so there is pretty much a complete colocalization of the junctions and our nanoparticle signal, which would indicate that this is the main pathway of accumulation in the plaque. And this is another image. This is cut through the plaque. It's full with our nanoparticles. And then here you see some zoom on the junctions. They are so-called focal adherence junctions. So during remodeling, they appear. And then in these discontinuities, you see accumulation of our material. And we also looked into the microvasculature. Because hoping that it also has some potential relevance. And sometimes we see beautiful network in the plaques, but this was very minor, a minor percentage. And so basically based on our histology, we see that it's like 0.5% of the plaque is actually contains the microvasculature. So it's really very low. And then, but if it's there, if we see the microvasculature, then we also see small channels full with our contrast agent. Well, not full, but still containing our contrast agent. So now we go to the macroscopic assessment. So whether we actually, with our zirconium-labeled nanoparticles, we can detect the lesions. So here is the autoradiography data for wild type and atherosclerotic aortas, and here you see these hot spots at the places where you do expect the lesions. So in the arch, atherosclerotic arch, in the bifurcations, and then once you quantify the signal with gamma counting, then you see significant difference, a significantly higher signal in the atherosclerosis. So we also applied truly non-invasive methods to assess the performance of our zirconium-labeled nanoparticles in a rabbit study. We induced atherosclerosis with a balloon injury and a high-fat diet combination, and there we were fortunate to be able to perform integrated PET MRI at Mount Sinai, and then we followed dynamically for 2 hours, and we also performed static scan at 12 and 24 hours after injection of our material. So this is a sample of our results. So here up, you see the fusion images, MRI in a gray scale, and this hot scale is our PET signal. And then here is the aorta, and you can over time see that the signal goes down, and here you can quantify the clearance. And for us, it was important to get rid of from the circulation as much as possible, and this was our readout time point. And here you see the image at 12 hours, and you see the hotspot in the abdominal aorta, which would indicate the specific association. And then the signal, quantified signal, non-invasively signal, in the aorta was like 6-7 times higher compared to the reference tissue. And this brings me to the last piece. So we were very curious what actually assembly does to the biological properties of hyaluronan. And so we performed a therapeutic study in atherosclerosis. We treated for 12 weeks, but one time a week injection with nanoparticles. And then compared to the free hyaluronan, which was the base of this formulation. And what the biggest differences we saw in the macrophage fraction and collagen fraction. So the nanoparticles actually decreased the macrophage fraction and increased the collagen. And these two findings, they say something about higher stability of these plaques. So this is the summary, but time's up, right? and these are all involved people in the study, and of course, I would like to thank you for listening.
Thank you for a very nice presentation and very nice study. Time for one or two very short questions. Yes, Paolo.
I don't know if you can hear me. Yes, you can. So based on your data, most of the particles are getting to the plaque from the major vessels. The vasa vasora, which you call the microvasculature, have really a minor contribution to the accumulation into the plaque. And so can you comment a little bit further about the mechanism then of accumulation from these large and very much perfused high-speed vessels?
So this is actually what we are now very much investigating. But so it's actually host endothelium, right? It's endothelium which covers the aorta. So this is just the pathway that actually they enter this is the pathway. We see that junctions are the primary pathway. We also considered a transendothelial transfer, right? But this seems to be of minor relevance. So yeah, I think leaky endothelium, host endothelium. Yeah, and if present, microvasculature as well, but this is really very rarely observed in mice.
Any circulating monocytes that may eventually infiltrate the plaque with the nanoparticles on board, like a sort of Trojan horse?
Right, but with our flow cytometry, we also screen for freshly recruited monocytes, and there we don't see it. We saw low levels, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Short, right? And then.
So I have a question. So nice presentation.
Thank you.
What about the macrophage type? So do you have one M1 or M2 macrophage?
From our colleagues, which are specialized on that, you cannot say anything about that. So in theory, you use pro-inflammatory. In practice, you cannot say anything.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Evelina.
Thank you.